Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Atomic Doctors, Conscience and Complicity at the Dawn of the Nuclear Age by James L. Nolan, Jr. Narrated by Adam Lofbomm. Introduction. On the morning of June 17, 1945, Captain James F. Nolan, M.D., boarded a plane in Albuquerque, New Mexico. In his briefcase was a highly sensitive report prepared by Nolan, along with other Manhattan Project physicians and two physicists, that expressed concerns about potential radioactive fallout from what would be the first nuclear bomb ever exploded. The plutonium bomb, or gadget as it was called, was scheduled for detonation in the Alamogordo bombing range of New Mexico in less than a month. Nolan and his colleagues hoped to persuade General Leslie Groves, military head of the Manhattan Project, to approve safety and evacuation procedures for the so-called Trinity test. After a flight delay, a missed connection, and a long train ride from Cincinnati to Knoxville, Nolan finally arrived at the Oak Ridge site of the Manhattan District at 6:30 the next morning. At Oak Ridge, about 25 miles outside Knoxville, Nolan eventually met with a large and imposing Groves, who was not at all pleased to receive the report. Groves made Nolan sit outside his office while he read the document and discussed it with his aides. When he finished, Groves called Nolan in and addressed him dismissively. "What are you, some kind of Hearst propagandist?" The comment, with its reference to William Randolph Hearst, known for his sensationalist journalism, was indicative of Groves' overriding concerns with security and secrecy. He feared that if the proposed plan were implemented, information about the top-secret Manhattan Project might leak out to people living near the Alamogordo bombing range. Such a response from Groves was not unexpected. In Nolan's view, the military was concerned only with making a bomb for the purposes of warfare. Worries about radiation hazards were entirely secondary. Groves, in Nolan's words, had rifle-barrel vision, which made him a great soldier, but limited him to thinking only of the security aspect. As it turned out, the Manhattan Project physicians were right to be worried about fallout from the Trinity test. Groves eventually approved some of the safety measures, but concerns about the long-term effects of radiation on the region around the test site persist to this day. Although the Manhattan Project doctors warned the military about dangerous fallout from the Trinity test, they also participated in downplaying the harmful effects of radiation following the test. The doctor's complicated role in this instance is emblematic of what happened a number of times at the dawn of the nuclear age. Manhattan Project doctors would offer warnings, particularly with respect to the dangers of radiation exposure. Military leaders would not take the warning seriously, giving greater weight to military and scientific concerns. Doctors would then be put in a position of helping the military to hide or minimize the negative consequences of radiation exposure, often out of fear of litigation. Atomic Doctors focuses on the physicians who were involved in the Manhattan Project, paying particular attention to Nolan, as well as his colleagues Lewis Hempelman and Stafford Warren, all of whom were part of the project from its earliest days, and then played important roles in the unfolding drama of the atomic age. All three doctors had training in radiology, and thus knew more than most about radiation, the critical and defining, yet mysterious, feature of the new weapon. How they gained and managed their knowledge about radiation, and how they treated, or didn't treat, those who were affected by it, is a central theme of this book. It's a theme that intersects with a continuing debate about the necessity and morality of detonating, and then continuing to develop and stockpile atomic weapons. We will hear how the doctors were used, with or without their cooperation, either to support or refute competing historical narratives about the atom bomb. James F. Nolan was my grandfather. I first became aware of the nature and scope of his contribution to the Manhattan Project when my mother visited me several months after my dad had passed away. She brought with her a box of materials that no one else in the family even knew existed. When I opened the box and began sorting through its contents, I was astonished by what I found. The box contained a treasure trove of data about my grandfather and his role in the Manhattan Project. I discovered photographs of the Trinity test, the USS Indianapolis, Tinian Island, Bikini Island, and Hiroshima and Nagasaki. taken just weeks after the bombs were dropped on the two cities. Also inside were my grandfather's military papers, travel itineraries, artifacts, souvenirs, weather maps, newspaper clippings, written accounts of his experience, and correspondence, including with Robert Oppenheimer, the scientific head of the Manhattan Project. Discovery of this material marked the beginning of my own journey through the early nuclear age, with my grandfather acting as my guide. In a sense, Nolan served as my Virgil, taking me through a divine comedy of sorts. He introduced me to fascinating people, including those who had visions of a technophilic new paradise. He showed me a horrifying inferno. The image conveyed by the Japanese doctors with whom Nolan interacted in Hiroshima and Nagasaki immediately after the war. The contents of my grandfather's secret box of materials led me on exploratory trips to a number of archives across the United States, to Los Alamos and Oak Ridge, to the San Ildefonso Pueblo, to a reunion in Indiana with the still-living survivors of the USS Indianapolis, and to Hiroshima and Nagasaki. The more I explored, the more interesting and troubling the story became. The Virgil image also works in the sense that the story is not so much about Nolan, though he is clearly a central figure, as it is about the dramatic and utterly transformative historical period he lived through. My grandfather participated in many of the crucial events of this period. He was involved in some way with the first 8 nuclear bombs ever detonated. He was there at Los Alamos. Indeed, he was one of the first recruits. He helped plan the safety and evacuation measures for the Trinity test. He was one of the 2 men tasked with escorting Little Boy, the bomb that would be dropped on Hiroshima from Los Alamos to the Pacific Islands. He was one of the first Americans to visit Japan and investigate the bomb sites after the war. He was present for the subsequent atomic tests on the Bikini and Inuitak atolls in the Marshall Islands. And at the very end of his life, he joined about 100 others to attend the 40th reunion of the start of the Manhattan Project in Los Alamos, an event that provided the scientists who built the bomb an opportunity for tortured reflection on all that had become of their invention. This book follows Nolan through these episodes and considers the ethical and medical issues faced by the doctors working on the project. My interest in my grandfather's journey is more than personal and more than historical. As a sociologist with a long-standing interest in the role of technology in modern society, I find that Nolan's story provides insights into our fraught relations with technology. Discovery of the bomb generated a host of nuclear technologies in the military, in energy, and in medicine, along with a variety of related technologies that continue to shape our lives. Lessons from the early atomic age help us deepen our understanding of how humans engage not only with nuclear and nuclear-engendered technologies, but also with such emerging technologies as genetic engineering, robotics, and nanotechnology. The forceful impact of technology, nuclear and otherwise, on human life is one of the multiple meanings of delivering Little Boy that will be explored as we follow Nolan's passage through the early atomic age. 1. Life at Los Alamos. It was the best of times, it was the worst of times. It was the spring of hope, it was the winter of despair. We had everything before us. We had nothing before us. We were all going direct to heaven. We were all going direct the other way. Charles Dickens, Tale of Two Cities. The youngest of 3 brothers, James Finley Nolan was born in Chicago on September 5, 1915, to Joseph and Bernice Nolan. When he was 5 years old, the family moved to St. Louis, where he would reside until leaving for college in 1931. For high school, my grandfather attended the John Burroughs School, where he met his future wife, my grandmother, Anne Lowry. Nolan spent his undergraduate years at the University of Missouri, from which he graduated in 1935, and attended the Washington School of Medicine in St. Louis, where he completed his MD in 1938. His parents, who were not wealthy, dedicated what resources they had to helping their youngest son complete medical school. Nolan's 2 older brothers, Joe Jr. and Eugene, would instead enter the military. James Nolan married Anne Lowry in August 1936. 2 years later, and just a couple of months after Nolan graduated from medical school, they welcomed a son, my father, James Lowry Nolan, into the world. Following medical school, Dr. Nolan completed a one-year internship in surgery, followed by 3 years of residency and assistantships in obstetrics and gynecology, all in St. Louis area hospitals. In 1942, Nolan moved with his young family to New York City to take up a fellowship at Memorial Hospital for more specialized training in physics and radiation therapy for the purposes of treating gynecologic cancer. This particular specialty had been a growing interest of Nolan's since encountering the reputable radiology department at Washington University. Nolan's fellowship at Memorial Hospital was cut short in February 1943, when he received a life-changing phone call from Lewis Hempelman, a good friend and medical school classmate. Hempelman, who graduated the same year as did Nolan, had spent 6 months at Berkeley in 1941 on a Commonwealth Fellowship, during which time he met Robert Oppenheimer. A few weeks before calling Nolan, Hempelman had met with Oppenheimer in Chicago. The new scientific director of the Manhattan Project very candidly briefed Hempelman on the purpose of the project and invited him to lead the health group at Los Alamos. "He was very open about it," Hempelman recollected. "He said they were going to try to make an atomic bomb." Hempelman, however, wasn't Oppenheimer's first choice. Oppenheimer had originally invited John Lawrence, brother of Berkeley physicist Ernest Lawrence, to head up the medical and health aspects of the work in Los Alamos. When John declined because of other commitments, Oppenheimer asked him to suggest someone else. He recommended his friend and squash partner, Lewis Hempelman. Nolan also wasn't Oppenheimer's first choice. He had originally invited Hannah Peters, a close friend and the wife of Bernard Peters, one of Oppenheimer's doctoral students at Berkeley, to take care of the health of the community. It's not entirely clear why Peters ultimately did not go to Los Alamos. "They were coming out here," said Hempelman. "Then they didn't, or couldn't, or something. I don't know the exact story there." Hempelman probably knew more than he was willing to admit in this instance, as it's likely the Peters didn't go to Los Alamos because of their communist affiliations and their failure to pass the security clearance. When things didn't work out with Hannah Peters, Hempelman recommended Nolan instead, an outcome Hempelman regarded as very fortunate. And I say fortunately because I met her, Peters, when I moved to Rochester in 1950. She had the laboratory next to me, and she was the nicest person in the world and very bright. She could no more handle the surgery and the obstetrics here than I could. And I know that I would have had to do all of this, and I am not very good at this sort of thing. So fortunately, when she dropped out, Oppie asked me if I knew of anybody. At this point, he turned to Nolan. "My friend Nolan," explained Hempelman, "had been trained as a surgeon, as an obstetrician, and he had also been involved in using radium to treat cancer patients. He was a very down-to-earth, practical person, and an excellent doctor." After accepting the offer to join the nascent Manhattan Project in late February 1943, Nolan, as he recounted, was taken on a strange secret mission to Washington to meet Dr. Oppenheimer and General Groves, where I was filled in on the idea of the Manhattan District, and was, of course, briefed on secrecy. It's significant and telling that secrecy was the memorable idea communicated to Nolan in this very first meeting with Groves and Oppenheimer, as secrecy would be an oft-repeated theme that would define and have serious consequences for the Manhattan Project and for Nolan's participation on it. At this initial meeting, Oppenheimer asked Nolan to recruit several nurses to join him in working at the hospital to be built on the Mesa. Oppie, as he was commonly called, thought that having medical facilities in place would aid his efforts in recruiting top physicists to the project. "I think that it will be reassuring to the people who come in," Oppenheimer wrote to Nolan in early March, "that we have a doctor and a nurse or two available." A few days later, Nolan confirmed with Oppenheimer the good news that he had successfully recruited two willing and able nurses from St. Louis, Harriet "Petey" Peterson and Sarah Dawson. St. Louis would serve as the primary recruiting place for most of the medical staff who worked at the Los Alamos Hospital during the war. Nolan was pleased not only that Peterson and Dawson were prepared to relocate quickly, but also that both had trained in pediatrics, an expertise, as would soon become clear, that would prove invaluable for work in the remote military hospital. In late March, Nolan and Hempelman joined Oppenheimer in Los Alamos to survey the mesa at the base of the Jemez Mountains in New Mexico. At the time, though construction was already underway, no one was living at the site except one soldier, whose quarters were furnished with little more than a sleeping bag. The only functional buildings on the property were from the former Los Alamos Ranch School, an institution that had been in operation since 1917, but that had just been forced off the mesa by the military in order to build the secret wartime lab. The members of the school's 1943 graduating class were made to accelerate their studies in order to participate in a late January graduation ceremony. After the survey trip in March, it was decided that Hempelman would remain a civilian and work in the technical area, or tech area, as it was known, monitoring radiation hazards, while Nolan would enter the military and serve as post-surgeon for the new hospital, providing for the general medical needs of the community. This particular division of labor was never strictly observed, as the two friends aided each other in their respective assignments, particularly during the first year in Los Alamos, when radiation issues were less pressing in the lab. Hempelman would help out at the hospital. Likewise, Nolan was never too far from the health and safety concerns of the lab. Even in Oppenheimer's first letter to Nolan, he discussed not only matters related to setting up a hospital, but also the need for medical personnel to help with blood counts. Oppenheimer wrote to Nolan, "Our whole radiological program will depend on having these counts made early in the game, before there are any radiation hazards." Oppenheimer thus conveyed both that he expected Nolan would be involved in some aspects of radiation safety, and that he was keenly aware of the hazards to which workers would soon be exposed once the processed uranium and plutonium began to arrive at the lab. It was initially understood that the medical staff would serve a small community of several hundred people. However, the population at Los Alamos grew steadily, and eventually surpassed, by a considerable margin, original estimates. Indeed, by the end of the war, the population at Los Alamos exceeded 6,500 civilian and military personnel. Also recruited to the Manhattan Project at this time was Stafford Warren, a 1922 graduate of the University of California Medical School, who had, since 1926, been on the faculty of the University of Rochester in the Department of Radiology. The older and more experienced Warren was recruited directly by Groves to serve as the chief medical officer of the Manhattan District. However, the 46-year-old Warren would be stationed not in Los Alamos, but at Oak Ridge, Tennessee, which had become the new official headquarters for the Manhattan Engineer District. At approximately the same time that Nolan and Hempelman were visiting Los Alamos in March 1943, Warren and Heimer Friedel, another early medical recruit to the Manhattan Project, were surveying an expanse of land 25 miles outside Knoxville, Tennessee, which would become the home of Site X. Here, too, major construction was underway for the development of the enormous Clinton Engineer Works, which would ultimately produce the purified uranium, U-235, for the Little Boy bomb to be dropped on Hiroshima. It was determined that Warren, like Nolan, should enter the military. Warren insisted that he be given the rank of colonel. Unlike Nolan, who was never really comfortable with military life, Warren relished his role as an army officer. According to one account, he showed up on his first day of work in combat boots with a .45 revolver strapped to his waist. Of these three primary Manhattan Project doctors, Nolan, Hempelman, and Warren, the last identified most closely with the military character of the operation. As journalist Eileen Welsom observes, though, Warren was also a scientist. He clearly saw himself as a military officer whose loyalty belonged to General Groves. This particular allegiance resulted in a bit of tension between Warren and some of the other doctors, including Robert Stone, who had become the head of the health division of the Metallurgical Lab, or Met Lab in Chicago, though still in a civilian capacity. Friedel, who became Warren's deputy at Oak Ridge, recalled that almost immediately after Warren became the chief medical officer of the Manhattan District, as an army colonel, there was a polarization between the Army and the University of Chicago, particularly Dr. Stone. The division, as such, was rooted in the essential differences between a scientific and a military perspective. A clash, as we will hear, that was evident in a broader sense at Los Alamos as well. In keeping with Grove's emphasis on compartmentalization, that is, that one should only be concerned with and know about one's particular assignment, Warren was not at first allowed to visit Los Alamos. During the first year of the project, he did not even know about Los Alamos. Hempelman acknowledged that, in the early days of the Manhattan Project, Staff Warren was not allowed to come out here, and the reason is known only to General Groves. After encountering Warren at a meeting, likely in Chicago, Hempelman determined that it would be useful for Warren to visit Los Alamos. He and Nolan then successfully appealed to Oppenheimer to make this happen. As Nolan recalled, "We convinced Oppie to get SW, Stafford Warren, to come here so we could get things done." Because Warren reported directly to Groves, the Los Alamos doctors thought that, with Warren more directly involved, they would have more of a voice with the general. Thereafter, the chief medical officer of the project would visit Site Y with some frequency. During these trips, Warren typically stopped by Oppenheimer's office, chatted with his secretary, Priscilla Green, and sometimes had a cup of coffee with the director, though on these occasions, he was always accompanied by either Nolan or Hempelman, with whom he spent most of his time while visiting Los Alamos. Competing paradigms. Present on the Manhattan Project, beginning in 1943 then, were three unique professional communities, which emphasized distinct and sometimes conflicting vocational characteristics: the academics, the military, and the much smaller community of medical doctors. The academics were primarily concerned with scientific discovery. Was it possible to harness the energy of an atom into a nuclear explosion? The Manhattan Project scientists, including 8 Nobel Prize winners, were from the country's and the world's leading universities. They were accustomed to the open exchange of ideas through seminar-style discussions and colloquia. The military, on the other hand, wanted a bomb for combat purposes. It emphasized secrecy, security, and a strict hierarchy of authority. Instead of the open sharing of ideas, it wanted an operational structure with clearly defined compartmentalization of tasks. Much has been written about the tension between the military and the scientists on the Manhattan Project. The academics chafed against the military culture, and the military cared little for the scientists. Groves referred disparagingly to the academics at Los Alamos as the children, long hairs, the greatest bunch of prima donnas ever assembled in one place, or even more unflatteringly, the largest collection of crackpots ever seen. The unfavorable feelings were rather mutual, as many in the scientific community disliked Groves and the regimented and security-conscious ways of the military, whom they referred to as fascists. As Jane Wilson, wife of the Princeton physicist Robert Wilson, put it, "Security was almost always inconsistent, often high-handed, and sometimes unjust. As a group, we civilians disliked the security office." Or, as the physicist Joseph Hirschfelder characterized the relationship between Groves and the scientific community, "He, Groves, never understood the scientists, and they thoroughly hated him." Such an attitude led to many complaints and frequent roasts of the military, and of Groves in particular. "We poked fun at security and censorship," Eleanor Jett, wife of the metallurgist Eric Jett, remembered, "and barbecued our general to a lush, crisp brown at regular intervals. We garnished him with the things we lacked and flamed him with rum before we served him." The medical doctors were marginally part of both communities, but not fully members of either. At least in theory, they were principally focused on matters of health and safety, on preserving and protecting life. This was not a top priority for either the military or the scientific community, and the doctors sometimes had difficulty getting members of these other groups to take their concerns seriously, particularly as they related to the dangers of nuclear radiation. As Nolan recalled in a 1957 letter to the author Richard Newcomb, "The radiation phase and possible hazards were not too important in those days. There was a war going on, and the engineers, that is, the military, were interested in having a usable bomb and protecting security. The physicists were anxious to know whether the bomb worked or not, and whether their efforts had been successful. The bomb was designed as a weapon of warfare, primarily using blast and heat for destructive forces, and radiation hazards were entirely secondary. Thus, the doctors were placed in a unique and difficult position, one that linked the arts of healing and war in ways that had little precedent. The salience of scientific and military commitments, and the unusual combination of both, pressed in on the doctors in ways that clearly challenged the core of their medical callings. How were they to manage these pressures? What compromises were they willing to make? Adding to the difficulties of their unprecedented roles in the context of the Manhattan Project, the physicians did not always feel entirely respected by the scientists. Henry Barnett, a pediatrician and later recruit to the Los Alamos Hospital, noticed this attitude when he arrived with his wife Shirley in July 1943. Barnett, who had also been a classmate of both Hempelman's and Nolan's at Washington University, had always regarded medicine as a rather prestigious profession. Thus, he was a bit taken aback by the attitude of some of the physicists when he began work at Los Alamos. "I had thought being a doctor was pretty far up on the pole, but not there," Barnett remembered. The physicists, many of them, sort of looked down on doctors, in part because the hospital doctors were technically part of the military. Warren likewise noted the difficulties faced by the Los Alamos doctors working with the world-renowned scientists at Site Y. "Even though Dr. Nolan and his crew were top flight," Warren recounted, "those PhDs would go to the library and ask for books and look up symptoms and make their own diagnosis half the time, thus causing quite a problem to the doctors there. In one instance, a worker with a broken leg was taken to the Los Alamos Hospital, while Nolan sometimes directed more serious injuries to Bruin's Hospital in Santa Fe. In this case, he determined that he and his staff could handle the patient's medical needs. The worker's scientific supervisor from the lab, however, questioned Nolan's assessment and advised that the patient be sent to Bruin's Hospital. Nolan turned the tables on this amateur doctor in order to push back on the unwelcome and not entirely atypical interference. "Tell me, how is the work going in your department?" Nolan asked the supervisor. "I mean, are you getting the work done? You know, I'm very interested in this because I think it's important to the whole project. Do you need any help in your department? Perhaps I could come in for a few minutes and set a few things right. You know, I've often thought that a new and uninformed point of view could do wonders in these scientific things." The group leader stammered in response. "Well, I hardly think..." Nolan continued. "Oh, that's all right. But if you need advice on anything, just call me. Be glad to help." According to Shirley Barnett, who overheard this conversation, Nolan's humorous repartee solved the problem. He had found a perfect solution for avoiding acrimonious discussions on medical subjects with such amateurs. In the context of the competing vocational paradigms, it appears as though the three doctors, Warren, Hempelman, and Nolan, in keeping with their particular institutional assignments, handled the pressures placed on the medical community differently, representing, one might argue, three ideal typical orientations: the military, the scientific, and the medical. Of the three, Hempelman, who reported directly to Oppenheimer, was the one most oriented toward the scientific paradigm. Nolan said of Hempelman that he never treated people. He was a theoreticer rather than a practitioner. He was more the archetype of the pure scientist. Hempelman, as head of the health group in Los Alamos, was very close to Oppenheimer, and after a stint doing research at Rochester University after the war, returned to Los Alamos to work at the lab. He never really worked as a doctor. Nor, for that matter, did Warren. As Nolan put it, Warren was supposed to be a radiologist, but really wasn't. After the war, Warren continued to work in more administrative capacities, including as dean of the new University of California, Los Angeles Medical School, and, as noted earlier, was, of the three doctors, the one most comfortable with the military character of the project. Nolan, on the other hand, as his son Lowry put it, saw himself first and foremost as a physician, whose number one concern was the welfare of his patients. His assignment as the post's hospital doctor, therefore, was in line with, and helped to foster this primary vocational understanding. Unlike either Warren or Hempelman, after the war, Nolan was keen to return to his role as a doctor, a medical practitioner. The three doctors, nevertheless, worked closely together during the war years and beyond, and they shared similar concerns about how best to protect people from the hazards of nuclear radiation, about which little was known at the time. While they seemed to have worked well together, there were also evidently some tensions between the three doctors. Hempelman and Nolan were and remained close friends, and while they respected Warren in many ways, they also regarded him as something of a politician, self-promoter, and storyteller, who was prone to exaggeration. Nolan remarked of Warren that he was a complete politician. He was a great salesman, good at what he did, but also full of it. Hempelman said that Warren was very flamboyant, a teller of tales. Because of this, it was difficult to believe anything he said. More recent assessments of Warren's character and leadership style echo Nolan's and Hempelman's accounts. Eileen Welsom, for example, describes Warren as garrulous and full of bravado, an extraordinary blend of contradictions, flamboyant and cautious, amiable and shrewd, a storyteller who kept secrets. Similarly, the author and lawyer Jonathan Weisgall depicts Warren as an energetic scientist, always amiable and polite. A dynamic speaker, he was also flamboyant and given to histrionics. These characterizations of this larger-than-life military doctor are borne out in the introduction to Warren's lengthy oral history project, with the revealing title, An Exceptional Man for Exceptional Challenges, put out by the Regents of the University of California. In the laudatory introduction to the publication, Warren's friend and colleague Paul Dodd acknowledges that Warren had his critics, who regarded him as too much of a builder, too much of a one-man man of action. The interviews for the Oral History Project were conducted in 1966 and 1967, though the edited version was not published until 1983. The long delay was mainly a result of difficulties the editing staff faced in corroborating the details of many of Warren's stories. Publication, in other words, was hampered because of Warren's exaggerations and chronic, and evidently well-known, inability to accurately recall people and places. Warren's specific Manhattan Project assignment, as a military doctor reporting directly to Groves, placed him in a difficult position. His personality and storytelling proclivities may have afforded him the dexterity to traverse the distinctive parameters of the medical and military paradigms, but one also senses that, at least at times, he was quite troubled by the nearly impossible task of balancing these not always congruent vocational commitments. That is, he was, at the same time, meant to oversee the health and safety of thousands of military and civilian personnel, working in unprecedented conditions with hazardous materials about which there was little understanding, while also obeying the directives of a demanding and difficult military boss, one described by his immediate deputy as the biggest son of a bitch I have ever worked for. The difficulties of this particular balancing act would only intensify over time, and not always in ways that benefited those in need of medical care. Shangri-La. After Nolan and Hempelman's exploratory visit to Los Alamos in March 1943, Nolan returned east to retrieve his family. By early April, he was back in New Mexico with his wife Anne, who was 5 months pregnant at the time, and their 5-year-old son Lowry. Nolan received an early lesson on the military's obsessive preoccupation with security and secrecy when, upon arrival in April, he was asked to destroy the pass issued to him during the March visit. He was required to write and sign a statement testifying that the pass was destroyed by burning. Dorothy McKibben, the project's friendly and resourceful gatekeeper, who with indefatigable alacrity greeted new arrivals at her headquarters at 109 East Palace Street in the center of Santa Fe, arranged for the young family to stay in temporary housing below the Mesa until their apartment building on the Hill, as it was commonly called, was completed. Sometime in late April, the Nolans moved in to one of the hastily constructed 4-unit Sunt apartment buildings, named after the contracting company that built the charmless, army-issued, olive-colored structures. Occupying the rooms directly above the Nolans was the family of physicist Dana Mitchell. Lowry Nolan would often play with the Mitchells' son, Didi, who had an electric train set extending the length of his room and circling up three levels, as well as a chemistry set, which included solutions for making disappearing ink. In their building's other two apartments were the families of photographer Julian Mack and physicist Sam Allison, who would 2 years later give the audible countdown for the Trinity test. The Nolans' four-room dwelling, apartment A of building T-135, was like the other Sunt units, fully equipped with a large and unwieldy wood-burning stove. And Nolan was afraid of the bulky stove, referred to on the Hill as a black beauty, and preferred instead to cook on an electric hot plate, which, because of multiple complaints about the wood stoves, were eventually issued to families living in the Sunt apartments. Among the four families in the Sunt unit next door to T-135 were the Tellers. The prickly Hungarian physicist Edward Teller, an advocate of the super or hydrogen bomb, kept unusual hours, sometimes playing his Steinway grand piano late into the night, which, because of the apartment's thin walls, could be heard by his neighbors. Adjacent to the Sunt apartments was Bathtub Row, so named because these were the only homes on the Hill with bathtubs. The houses on Bathtub Row, previously occupied by the administrative and teaching staff at the ranch school, were the homes of the upper echelon of project personnel, including the Oppenheimers and the families of physicist Kenneth Bainbridge and Navy Captain William Deke Parsons. Particularly during the first year in Los Alamos, when the community was smaller and when the pressure to complete the bomb was less intense, it was an exciting and exhilarating place to live. Situated atop the Pajarito Plateau, between the Sangre de Cristo Mountains to the east and the Jemez Mountains to the west, the isolated mesa was stunningly beautiful. Oppenheimer, who played a role in selecting the location, had for a long time been in love with the region, which he regularly visited in the years before the war. He and his brother Frank owned a small ranch house in the nearby Pecos Valley called Perro Caliente, which was about a 40-mile horse ride from Los Alamos. Oppenheimer wrote to a friend in 1929, "My two great loves are New Mexico and physics. Too bad they cannot be combined. With Los Alamos, these two affections were united." Though years later, when Oppenheimer had come to regret much of what had become of the scientist's revolutionary invention, he lamented, "I am responsible for ruining a beautiful place." In the early months on the Hill, residents worked hard and played hard. On Sundays, which Oppenheimer insisted be a day off, residents explored the region, taking long hikes and horse rides, visiting the ancient ruins of Bandelier National Monument, or picnicking in the surrounding countryside. Kitty Oppenheimer, among others, was an avid and accomplished horse rider, and the stables from the former ranch school were used for boarding the animals. During the winter, residents skied and ice skated. Not only did Nolan and Hempelman work together on the Hill, their families were close during their time in Los Alamos. When Nolan's daughter Lynn was born, the first baby to be born at Site Y, Hempelman and his new bride, Eleanor, were asked to be her godparents. 2 months before Lynn's birth, Hempelman had briefly left Los Alamos and returned to St. Louis in order to marry Eleanor Pulitzer, daughter of Joseph Pulitzer II, the editor and publisher of the St. Louis Post-Dispatch, and granddaughter of Joseph Pulitzer, the founder of the Pulitzer Prize. Adjusting to life on the Hill was not entirely easy for the lovely and high-society Eleanor Hempelman, who continued, in spite of her new, nearly camp-like surroundings, to dress impeccably and in keeping with the more refined social world to which she was accustomed. Though generally a good sport and able to make fun of her altered circumstances, she once commented in exasperation to Shirley Barnett, "I'm just so sick of looking at all the ugly people in the commissary." The Hempelmans, who never had children of their own, were also the godparents of Robert and Kitty Oppenheimer's children, Peter and Tony. The Hempelmans remained close to the Oppenheimers after the war. In fact, Peter and Tony stayed with the Hempelmans during Oppenheimer's disastrous tribunal in 1954. And Peter Oppenheimer and his young family lived for a season with the Hempelmans outside Santa Fe. Lynn remembers her godparents as very charming people, with a relatively young population living on the hill. The place was renowned for its spirited parties. Shirley Barnett recalled that the parties were naturally pretty wild, and all drank like fish. At an elevation of 7,400 feet above sea level, the alcohol was all the more potent. Elsie McMillan, wife of future Nobel Prize-winning physicist Ed McMillan, remembered drinking more at the Los Alamos parties than she ever had before. She viewed it as almost a necessity, given the immense pressure placed on the scientists. It was a way to let off steam. You had to let off this feeling eating your soul. Oh God, are we doing right? Among the many parties thrown on the hill was a costume party sponsored by the Nolans and the Hempelmans at the PX, Post Exchange, with the provocative theme, "Come as your suppressed desire." Oppenheimer dressed as a waiter, wearing an ordinary suit with a napkin over his arm. Dorothy McKibben, making the 35-mile drive from Santa Fe for the event, wore a leopard skin outfit with a long coat draped over her shoulders. The overworked medical staff came in their pajamas, with pillows strapped to the back of their heads, expressing their wish for an uninterrupted night's sleep. Hempelmann sheepishly admitted that, while in pajamas and a robe, he also wore a sign that read, "I am Rita Hayworth." Alice Hemholtz, wife of physicist Lindsay Hemholtz, conveying her desire to escape the confines of the isolated military post, came dressed in city clothes, with gloves and a suitcase. As Hempelmann remembered, she wanted to get the hell out of here as fast as she could. Others dressed up as celebrities, starlets, or historical figures. Someone came wearing roller skates and made circles around the PX during the evening. "That was a very gay party," Hempelmann reminisced. Another memorable party was the one Kitty Oppenheimer threw to celebrate her husband's 40th birthday on April 22, 1944. During the celebration, Oppenheimer made his famous martinis, and the alcohol flowed rather freely. Everybody, even the most sober people like Isidore Robbie, were feeling no pain at all, recalled Hempelmann. Everyone was dancing, and we all had a marvelous time. Some of Oppenheimer's former Berkeley colleagues put together a mock yearbook to commemorate the event. Using the mugshot-like pictures from the site's security passes, the publication was organized in the style of a high school yearbook. With Oppenheimer as class president, Dorothy McKibben as the welcoming committee, and Hempelmann, Nolan, and Barnett, along with six nurses, as the 4-H Club, likely an allusion to the fact that the medical staff sometimes engaged in veterinarian services on the hill. The British mission sponsored one of the last big parties on the hill just after the war ended. A group of some 20 members of the British mission, led by the prominent British physicist Sir James Chadwick, had arrived beginning in December 1943 to join the effort at Los Alamos. In addition to Chadwick, members of the delegation included British physicist William Penny, with whom Nolan would later travel to Japan, and the German-born Klaus Fuchs, who would eventually be tried and found guilty in a British court for passing valuable nuclear secrets to the Russians. Perhaps the most famous member of the British mission was the beloved Danish physicist Niels Bohr, who went by the codename Nicholas Baker, or as he was affectionately called by most in Los Alamos, Uncle Nick. The British mission party was held at Fuller Lodge, a handsome and sturdy log building left over from the ranch school days and mostly used for dining during the war years. Entertainment at the big event featured British physicist Ernest Titterson on the piano and a comical English pantomime mocking the Trinity test, security, and other aspects of life on the hill. The climax of the evening, Dorothy McKibben recalled, was when everyone rose to their feet, brandishing their paper cups, and drank to the king's health with sparkling burgundy. In addition to the parties, other recreational activities included twice weekly 15-cent movies at the Post Theater, square dances, choral and theater groups, chess club, and Spanish classes. Residents also formed a PTA, participated in a basketball league, and played softball, tennis, and even golf. Protestant and Catholic church services were offered in the Post Theater on Sunday mornings, often requiring considerable cleanup from the party or dance held in the same building on the previous evening. Residents would occasionally escape the confines of the fenced-in military compound for trips to Santa Fe, where they could eat and drink at La Fonda, a favorite drinking hole in the center of Santa Fe, or gather for small parties, and even a number of weddings, at Dorothy McKibben's house. After their arrival, Lowry Nolan was soon enrolled in kindergarten, which, before the new school building was completed, at first met in an apartment across the street from their unit. Lowry's first teacher, Mrs. Tinsley, would ring a bell to announce the start of the school day. The new school building, when it was completed, offered breathtaking views of the Jemez Mountains through large paned windows. Lowry found life on the hill enchanting, and the families of the famous physicists fascinating. He enjoyed the games and adventures the children created on the site and in the surrounding hills. In addition to his work at the hospital, Dr. Nolan was elected to the town council established by the civilians at Los Alamos. He also helped to equip the new nursery school, while his wife Anne played a role, along with Eleanor Hempelman, in setting up a laundry facility that was used by both military and civilian personnel, and established in part with the goal of easing the tensions between the two communities. Though there was much to enjoy among the various activities initiated by the creative and ingenious people living at Shangri-La, as it was sometimes called, residents also had to endure considerable hardships and inconveniences, not the least of which was the intense surveillance to which the scientists and their families were relentlessly subjected. Mail was censored, and telephone calls were monitored and sometimes recorded. Security even followed some of the scientists when they traveled off the hill. Because of his early years as an admitted fellow traveler of communist causes, Oppenheimer was among the most scrutinized of the scientific community. His surreptitious visit in June 1943 to the home of his former mistress, Jean Tatlock, who was still living in Berkeley, did not help matters. Tatlock's communist ties were well known, and Oppenheimer's visit was carefully observed by security. Pierre de Silva, head of security at Los Alamos, was so suspicious of Oppenheimer that, a few months after Oppenheimer's clandestine visit to Tatlock's Berkeley home, he offered to his superiors his opinion that Oppenheimer was playing a key part in the attempts of the Soviet Union to secure, by espionage, highly secret information which is vital to the security of the United States. Oppenheimer was largely shielded from the repercussions of such warnings because of Grove's interventions and protection. In one of the most improbable partnerships imaginable, the radically different Groves and Oppenheimer worked well together. Grove saw Oppenheimer as essential to the project and, as such, was willing to overlook his communist-leaning past. However, Grove's support did not stop ongoing surveillance of the project's scientific director. According to Robert Wilson, Oppenheimer complained constantly that his telephone calls were monitored. The director was not the only member of the community who grumbled about and deeply resented military oversight and surveillance. Wilson's wife, Jane, found the military scrutiny to be oppressive, unreasonable, and excessive. "I couldn't write a letter without seeing a censor poring over it," she wrote. "I couldn't go to Santa Fe without being aware of hidden eyes upon me watching, waiting to pounce on that inevitable misstep. It wasn't a pleasant feeling." In short, she said, living at Los Alamos was something like living in jail. One day, Anne Nolan was preparing to go to the PX to pick up a few items for her family and for the Hempelmans, because Eleanor was at home with a head cold. The two friends reviewed their respective shopping lists over the phone. As Anne stepped out of her son's apartment, standing at her door were two military police officers. Two others were at the Hempelmans' apartment. Anne and Eleanor spent an hour and a half explaining themselves and asserting their innocence. Evidently, they had inadvertently used the secret password for the day during their phone conversation, which happened to be peanut butter. The experience intimidated the hell out of them, Lynn Handy remembers. It was paranoia city up there. Really, it was. In addition to the resentment toward heavy-handed military surveillance, residents also struggled with the difficulties of living in crowded and cheaply built housing. The Sunt apartments were among the nicer housing options at Site Y. Smaller and more shoddy units, which included squatty hutments, government trailer units, and large and utilitarian barracks for the Women's Army Corps and enlisted men, were quickly built to accommodate the ever-increasing number of people living and working in Los Alamos. With limited comforts and the almost slum-like conditions of these sprawling housing units, it's no wonder that the comparatively more commodious four-family Sunt unit complex was sometimes referred to as Snob Hollow. Though the military town continued to expand, the roads remained unpaved, resulting in dusty summer months and frustratingly muddy conditions in late winter and early spring, in which cars sometimes got stuck. Water on the mesa was also an ongoing problem, causing the doctors no little anxiety. Warnings about water rationing were a regular item in the community's daily bulletin. With all the hazardous materials and explosive testing on the site, the doctors constantly worried about potential fires. They feared that, in case of a fire, they just didn't have enough water to save the buildings. Nolan and the Los Alamos Hospital. With the interesting people and the varied extracurricular activities atop the gorgeous mesa, the military oversight and other trying conditions notwithstanding, it was a unique and exciting time. Nolan's principal preoccupation, however, was with his work at the new hospital. With Henry Barnett's arrival in July 1943, the hospital staff comprised Nolan, Barnett, and three nurses. The staff also included a secretary and two boys from a nearby pueblo serving as hospital orderlies. At this time, the hospital had only 6 beds and an operating room, with a few additional small rooms that served as offices, conference rooms, and a pharmacy. The facility was so small that visitors had to stand outside the building, sometimes on crates or packing boxes, in order to visit patients through the window. When the operating room was in use, those waiting for appointments were also made to stand outside. The hospital, which was situated across from the tech area on the opposite side of Ashley Pond, was in the center of the growing town. The lights in the operating room were bright enough that everyone at Site Y knew when the doctors were operating at night. One evening, Ann Nolan and Shirley Barnett were waiting for their husbands outside the hospital building. At the time, Ann was only weeks away from giving birth to her daughter Lynn, and the community was anxiously looking forward to the first newborn on the hill. As the two women waited in the dark, the driver of a passing car, noticing the lights on in the hospital, slowed down to ask Shirley whether Ann was in the delivery or operating room. In answer to this inquiry, Ann stepped out of the dark shadows to reveal her still very pregnant condition. The experience made the shy and somewhat reserved Ann hope that she would give birth during the more inconspicuous daytime hours. Ann's wish was not realized, as her daughter was born on the evening of August 16, 1943. Given that her husband was the only OBGYN in town, and Hempelman was evidently queasy at the sight of blood, it was rumored that he actually passed out during one attempt at a delivery. Nolan was made to deliver his own child. Hempelman was originally meant to deliver Lynn, but at the last minute, Nolan decided that he didn't trust his friend with the job, and instead assigned Hempelman the role of anesthetist. Hempelman acknowledged that this was a wise choice. Jim, as I said, was a first-rate obstetrician, a very good doctor. He worked well with his hands. In the small community, as Shirley Barnett recalled, Lynn's birth was regarded as a major event and a matter of loud huzzah. The local San Ildefonso Pueblo community celebrated the occasion by giving Lynn the Tewa name Povitasay, which means yellow flower, presumably because of her blonde curls, an unusual sight on the mesa. A day of dancing in the plaza of the nearby pueblo was offered in commemoration of Lynn's birth, likely the corn dance, which is performed in the late summer or early fall. Fittingly, the purpose of the corn dance is for the fertility of all things, the crops, the beasts, and man himself. Lynn's birth may have been the first on the hill, but it was hardly the last. With the average age of residents at 25, starting and growing families was a popular activity. Because medical care was free, the hospital was nicknamed RFD for Rural Free Delivery. In the first year alone, 80 babies were born, which kept Nolan and Barnett very busy. sometimes when a delivery occurred late at night. Army Sergeant Myron Weigel would drive to Nolan's home, enter his bedroom, awaken him, and then escort the doctor to the hospital in the ambulance. He would return Nolan to his apartment in the same manner after the delivery. The most celebrated birth on the Hill was that of Tony Oppenheimer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.